because there are so many people here distinguished that if I try to acknowledge them all, I am sure I will not be able to do justice to it. I'm here to talk about family. However, or Atta Mills, the family man. Talking about family, there are a few people, though, that I would like to especially acknowledge. Number one, family. Professor Mills's very close collaborator, who served as his chief of staff, the man responsible for Professor Mills being called President Doolittle. Because I found out that whenever President Mills wanted to do something that Henry John Martin Newman didn't like, he said, "Fifi, let's pray over it." But whenever Fifi wanted to do something that John Henry Martin Newman wanted, it was done immediately. So blame him for Fifi not doing that much, at least in his first year. And blame him also for the high achievements that Fifi had in his presidency. I'd be remiss if I didn't recognize another family member called Nana Jane Opokuagyeman. I didn't know this when I met her in Dakar, Senegal, as a young, bright student studying at the University of Dakar. She used to speak French very well. I don't know whether she's forgotten it. It's only later that I found out that she was actually one of my mother's pets. She would come to my mother's shop, bookstore opposite the post office in Kisi, knowing fully well that she'd be getting some toffees from my mother. I was delighted, therefore, when she became the running mate of John Dramani Mahama. She is truly a family member and a sister. There are also a number of greedy bastards here. And one that has a special name, the little tweet. I'll be talking about them later. But I would like to thank them, I would like to acknowledge them, because I know that they were very key in Fifi's presidency, good and bad. I unfortunately have not seen the chief greedy bastard here, and that is Senior Atu Ahoy. I've seen Kwame Pepra, I've seen others, but I understand he's not doing that well. I send him my prayers, and please, let him know that we love him and we'll come to visit him very soon. Now, please let me introduce myself. My name is Nana Kojo Esiao Dufu I. The Ebusunya Penyin of the Nkrumah Cherba Trade and Ebusunya of Cape Coast. I said it much better than my sister would have said it. I listened to her. She really muffled it up when she gave the vote of thanks the other day. Behind me is the deputy, Ebusia Penyin, Dr. John Atram. I think they chose him only because they wanted a doctor, as the representatives of the family. And of course, behind me also is Mr. Ni Ayi Thompson, who is the chairman of the Nkumacherba Tridanebusia. They are standing behind me to make sure that I don't say the wrong thing. If you see that I'm lifting my leg, it's because they've kicked me from behind. But it's all in a normal day work as the chief honcho of the Nkumacherba Tridanebusia. Let me tell you something about the illustrious Tridanebusia of Cape Coast that have actually produced a number of people who have made contributions to Ghana. You people boast about the sports prowess of John Fifi Atta Mills. Believe me, he is nothing compared to Africa's number one goalkeeper, Robert Mensah, of blessed memory. It's a family also that produced the person that I call my nephew with the voice of honey, Amanziba Nat Brew, a great musician. It's a family that produced Ambassador Kwesi Brew, who was not necessarily of the same political persuasion as we are, but was a very prominent person that served Ghana in his role as ambassador. We have in the family also the Adakwes, whose claim to fame is that Kofi Annan of United Nations is the direct maternal uncle of the Adakwes. More recently, in terms of national service, of course, we have the not so honorable, not so Asomdwehene, the man who has been in the news all over the place in this last week. By the way, I call him not so honorable, not because of him, but Kwame Pienim told us not to call any member of parliament honorable. And therefore, he's not unique in that sense. Samuel Atta Mills, the nemesis of Kuku Anido. I am standing before you here because I think I have also made my contributions to this nation. For one, I was a senior presidential economic advisor to President Mills when he was president. As the role of advisor, of course, I take credit for all of the achievements under President Mills. And I refuse credit for all the failures because he didn't listen to me, which was always the case with Fifi. My other titles is that I was almost the Minister of Defense. And I don't know whether you know it, but I was also almost the ambassador of Ghana to the United States. In fact, it was publicly announced only for John Dramani Mahama to tell me, well dodged. I have not been able to live it down. The greedy bastards and Ludwig Klotze spend all their time calling me the disappointed defense minister, the disappointed ambassador. But in truth, I was the economic advisor, and that I'm very proud of. Then finally, of course, the illustrious, my brother, John Evans Atta Mills, who we are here to celebrate today. So as you can see, it's a family that has made its contributions, and it's a family that I'm really, really, really proud now to be leading. As a family, we treasure a lot of things. But above all, what we treasure are situations like this, commemorative lectures that remind us of Fifi, who he was, what he stood for, and make us realize that maybe he may be dead in terms of his physical presence, but Fifi will never die. And Fifi lives on. Now, I had really wanted to be the person to give the 10th anniversary lecture. In fact, I had been lobbying Professor Kwame Nahoy to suggest to those in power who were going to nominate the person to make me the person to give the 10th anniversary lecture for my brother. As usual, he promised me that he will do everything that he would do. And I had actually prepared my address. When Ludwig Klotze came and told me that it doesn't look good, Kadman. You may not very well be the person to give the lecture. And in anticipation of becoming a Busuyapenyin and knowing that I wasn't going to be the one to give the lecture, I was determined that we were going to boycott this lecture if I wasn't the person. Just like we boycotted the other thing, right? And then they told me, we are sorry, but it's Chachu, who doesn't even deserve a second name, who is going to give the lecture. As they say in Fante, if he's in a misafim. Chachu? They couldn't have made a better choice, Chachu. And I had to call off the boycott immediately. Chachu was with Fifi in 2004 when things didn't go very well for us. Chachu was with Fifi in 2006, I was there, in South Africa when Fifi was contemplating his future as a politician. Chachu has always been there for Fifi. Chachu did a lot of things that actually, at the time, I didn't realize, but later on, got to know about it. If anybody other than me, of course, is to make the commemorative lecture, it should be Chachu. I don't want to spook you off out, but I'm really looking forward to it. And thank you for accepting to come and speak. In that same vein, let me thank the John Evans Atta Mills Memorial Heritage. We'll get to that. Why are you so impatient? For organizing the series of regional lectures, and in particular the Accra lecture to commemorate him on his 10th anniversary. You would note that actually immediately after Fifi died, Mrs. Mills and I got together and very rapidly registered the John Evans Atta Mills Memorial Foundation in order to get a foot in the door and make sure that we use the foundation to raise resources and funds in order to support initiatives such as that which is being done by the Atta Mills Memorial Heritage. Because for Mrs. Mills and I, it was very important to make sure that Fifi's legacy was not bastardized by anybody, and that Fifi's legacy and the custody of the legacy rested in the hands of the people who truly loved him, who were truly committed to him, and who truly wanted to use his name to advance his ideas and his values and his principles. Now, I've become aware of other initiatives, and I will not beat about the bush. The Atta Mills Institute, run by Koku Anyidohu, and which was responsible, apparently, in mobilizing support for refurbishing Asomdwe Park. I went there yesterday again because I wanted to be sure that I saw what I really think I saw. The Asomdwe Park and the work that was done there. Differences, of course, in aesthetics being acknowledged. I'm sorry, it's obscene, to use a very strong word. I did not recognize Fifi there. It was the very first time that I went to a Somdwe Park that I was not emotional. The place, of course, is called Somdwe Park. There are his pictures everywhere. Some quotations of him. His name doesn't appear in any of the quotations, except, of course, the logo of the Atta Bills Institute. I saw his grave. There his name appeared a little bit, except that it was spelled John Evans Atta Mills with a hyphen between the two, for somebody who claimed to know him very well, even though the person who has the name himself has never put a hyphen in that name. Otherwise, everything was about them. And they used this so-called refurbishing to promote themselves, to promote their institute, and to promote their paymasters. That's not what Fifi stood for. Fifi hated people who self-promote. In fact, when Fifi said of a colleague that he is full of himself, and he would emphasize the word full of himself, or infante, meaning he has a foul smell in his nose, then you knew that that colleague has been written off in Fifi's mind, and he would never pay any attention to him because it's all about themselves. Fifi was somebody also who never really took himself seriously. In fact, he was a master of self-deprecating humor. He often laughed at himself because he thought it wasn't necessary to take himself too seriously. But by God, he took Ghana seriously, and I agree with you. And above all, he took Ghanaians very seriously in their future. In view of the fact that Atta Mills Institute is being used as an instrument to sow division, to sow controversy, for self-promotion, as an instrument to insult elders, in my capacity as the oldest living sibling of Professor John Evans Atta Mills, as the person who Professor Mills designated in his will to be the executor of his will and also the custodian of his legacy. And now in my capacity as the Ebusia Penyin of the Nkuma Cheruba Trida Nebusia, the family has decided that we will contact our solicitors to make sure that they explore all avenues to stop the Atta Mills Institute from operating. It's not going to be easy. It's not going to be easy. In fact, I thought of making a call to you to be part of the team, but I'm told that your record with the current judiciary is not very good. Because of you, there's always the unanimous seven. You may be a legal luminary, but please stay out of it. But finally, we will not just simply rely on the courts. I would like, therefore, to make an appeal to the court of public opinion, which I think is the only court worthwhile. I would like Ghanaians to know that the so-called Atta Mills Institute is unauthorized. It is also unsanctioned. It is unappreciated. And it's most unwelcome. I repeat, I know I'm speaking too long, but I think this is important. I want the Ghanaian public to know that the Atta Mills Institute, so-called, is unauthorized, unsanctioned, unappreciated, unwelcome. May God be with you, my brothers and sisters.
Atta Mills gbe na na gbe bo wa na ko be ja swi se ba ya na ka be ne bo ya bi ya wole gana bi yen ba na wa afu amandia o you know heba anya ba ko na na wa afu amandia.
Whilst the Our Group is performing, our distinguished Archbishop of Accra, Catholic Archbishop of Accra, would like to take leave of us, please. The Archbishop of Accra, Archbishop Bonaventure Kofi, would like to take leave of us, please. Thank you. Alright, Ada, our group, we thank you very, very much. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to remind you that we're live on Metro TV, Adum FM and Adum TV, Radio Gold, Wazer TV, thinknewsonline.com, TV XYZ, Power FM. Once again, we're live on Metro TV, Joy News, Adum TV, Adum FM, Radio Gold, Wazer TV, thinknewsonline.com, TV XYZ, and Power FM. At this stage, I would like us to meet those of us who haven't seen him before, and this is your first time. I'd like to introduce to you the son of our late president, Kofi Sam Atta Mills, and his beautiful wife. Thank you, and I have a few personalities here as well. Mrs. Anna Enin is also here. Thank you very, very much. Ambassador Victor Gbeho, thank you for your presence. Nana Yajantua, thank you very much for coming. Yes, and I have Comrade Bernard Mona. Thank you, Bernard. And of course, my mentor in journalism, the Venerable Kwesi Pratt. At this stage, ladies and gentlemen, if I may have your attention, this is the main event. This is the main event of the evening. Indeed, a lot has been said about this person by the respectable Dr. Cadman Mills, but we know without doubt that he's an academic, he's a legal luminary, what our friend in Nigeria would say, a colossus when it comes to the law. He is indeed an avatar of the law. And some people even think he is the law. Ladies and gentlemen, for our commemorative lecture, I would like us to give a resounding round of applause as I invite the honorable, distinguished lawyer, Chachu Chikata. Let's hear it, let's hear it, let's hear it, let's hear it, let's hear it. Thank you.
Nana, Chairman, and Togbi, Chairman of the Advisory Council. I believe the Archbishop of Accra and the Chief Imam are gone, but I would still like to acknowledge them and acknowledge Ebusi Apenyin Cadman, who now has to become the Asomdwihene. Excellencies, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, it is an honor for me to be asked by the President Mills Memorial Heritage to speak at the 10th anniversary event, commemorating the passing of a remarkable human being, whom I was privileged to have known from our days at the Faculty of Law, University of Ghana, Legon. He was 3 years my senior when we were students, and we later were colleagues when teaching. He was president for just over 3.5 years, having served earlier from 1996 to 2000 as vice president. President Mills earned global respect as an exemplar of integrity in political leadership. I want to suggest that the impact of his leadership goes beyond his lifetime, and that now more than ever, his legacy is critical for our nation's future. We can recall how in death he brought the nation to a unified acknowledgement of his stature in a manner that has been without equal. Even political opponents of his could not help acknowledging what he represented for the country and how his character had been an important stabilizing and moral force for our collective good in that period. I'd just like to ask us at this stage to recall in our minds the national acknowledgement when news of his death broke, right up to the solemn funeral attended by international dignitaries, including the presidents of neighboring Cote d'Ivoire and Togo, Mr. Kofi Annan, and the then U.S. Secretary of State, Hillary Clinton. In death, the strength of Professor Mills' personality and his stature as Asomdwihene brought this country together in grief in a very powerful way. I've been excited to learn of the countrywide nature of the memorials that are being organized to honor President Mills and the long-term plans of the memorial heritage. This is because I am convinced that his stature will grow bigger and bigger in the years and decades ahead. I have that conviction because of the outstanding legacy of integrity that he has left behind. That is what I've chosen to highlight today under the theme for these memorial events, the man John Evans Atta Mills, 10 years on. I believe that his legacy is even more vital today amidst the travails of our nation, as well as what I see as a global crisis of leadership. Today, more than ever, we can appreciate the importance of the human qualities of the man John Evans Atta Fifi Mills. So I would like to start with some remarks about the man. I will then consider how he got into his roles in politics and proceed to outline a few of his important achievements as president. It will not surprise you that I will dwell a bit on achievements in the oil and gas sector and highlight the relevance of those achievements for the future of that sector. It will be my thesis, broadly, that the life and work of President Mills represent a gold standard of leadership which our nation desperately needs. I will be insisting that, especially for our youth, President Mills shines a clear light for our nation's future, which we cannot just applaud or even just claim to be inspired by. Our honoring his memory is not so much about raising physical monuments to him, but more about ensuring that his legacy of integrity is given full meaning in our nation and in what we demand of our leaders as well as ourselves. Since Sunday morning, 24th July 2022, we have seen at Asomdwoe Park, President Mills' resting place, that what is now inscribed over his grave and under his bust does not even have his name. Was he really the one being honored in that event where this inscription was unveiled? But I can almost hear him, after listening to me utter those last two sentences, saying calmly, "Oh, Dama, man kasa wong wai. Oh, really, don't bother about them." And then asking me to move on to the more important subjects that he and I need to discuss. President Mills aspired to a better Ghana. That is undoubtedly a shared aspiration we all have as Ghanaians, unless the circumstances of our absurd partisan politics make some refuse to share that aspiration because it was espoused by someone from a political party other than the one they belong to. We shall look at how even his short time as president saw some important steps he took towards that Better Ghana agenda. And more importantly, how his human qualities can help our quest for a better Ghana, our resolve to make our nation great and strong. Let me stress from the beginning that I do not seek to idolize President Mills, because that would not even be fair to him. He was a servant leader who never sought to be idolized, and he would not accept that. He was indeed a human being and had his limitations and weaknesses, just like all of us. What I'm interested to do on this occasion, commemorating the 10th anniversary of his death, is to distill from his life qualities that are worthy of our attention and emulation. President Mills was a man with a deep devotion to Ghana and to public service. From his days as a lecturer in Legon, teaching both at the Faculty of Law and the School of Administration, his subjects being company law and tax law, through the time of his involvement in the reform of the country's revenue agencies, and then his becoming vice president and eventually president, his life was one dedicated to the country. He did not seek to enrich himself or his family or friends in the course of any of his commitments to serve. His simplicity, humility, and modesty, combined with his integrity, meant that he was fundamentally seeking the public good and not his personal benefits. As president, he would often sacrifice personal comfort and convenience to spare the nation undue expense on himself. He was frugal about expenditures at the presidency and thus set an example for his staff and for his ministers and other public servants. It was never about his entitlements, but rather what the people he was dedicated to serving were entitled to expect from a leader like him. Sadly, some believe that politics is all about winning power with no moral boundaries. It's all about enriching oneself. President Mills was the polar opposite of that mentality. On the 18th of June 2008, speaking at a forum, yes, you know what happened on the 18th of June 2008 to me. Speaking at a forum organized by the Institute of Economic Affairs, he said with deep meaning, and I quote, "There can be no doubt that the 2008 election is also about leadership and character, about the human qualities of the person into whose hands the people of Ghana are going to entrust their future. I, Atta Mills, bring to the table the core values of truth, honesty, and humility which have guided me through life. I believe political leadership and decency are not mutually exclusive," unquote. Throughout President Mills' political life, he maintained his human decency. This was, in fact, an important part of his political capital. He did not need to make promises or proclamations about his integrity. He lived integrity. The fire of integrity was evident in his famous encounter with customs officials at the Tema port, when he was calling the officials to order over the corruption among them that was eroding the revenue base of the nation. He could express himself so vehemently and categorically because he himself embodied the virtue he was demanding in others. President Mills angrily turned away anyone who tried to make approaches to influence him with money. I recall an account he gave of some business people soon after he was sworn in as president, making overtures of arrangements which they indicated they previously had, which they wished to continue, involving making monetary provision for his needs. He drove them away fiercely, with a warning that if he heard that anybody in his government was accepting any payment from them, they and the recipient of the payments would be in serious trouble. We all know that it could never be said of President Mills, whether by the chairman of his own party or anybody else, that he himself was receiving everything at the castle and not allowing anything to come to the party. He valued the peace and unity of the country so much that he would not be goaded into seeking political vengeance by making people in the previous administration targets of persecution during his presidency. Though he was under pressure to expose wrongdoing that had taken place previously, he considered that his priority was to focus on the development of Ghana and the well-being of her citizens within a framework of unity. President Mills was not one to orchestrate the jailing of people he considered political opponents. He absolutely meant it when he said, even before becoming president, that he was going to be a president for all Ghanaians, irrespective of political party affiliation. He said in the speech that I quoted earlier, he said so in these words, "I'm committed to a decent, honest, humble, and truthful government to mend the broken trust between government and the people. I will be president for all Ghanaians, not the NDC, not my family, not my friends. I want to leave an enduring legacy of a peaceful and united country where there is opportunity and prosperity for all. And I want to be remembered as a president who restored honesty, truth, and sincerity to government." Unquote. These words, spoken with conviction and absolute sincerity, reflected the fact that his character was a major part of what he was offering the nation. They reflected his assurance to us that he would not be succumbing to the temptations of political power. He lived up to those declarations totally. He was a father for all, as indeed a president should be. That may not exactly have been music to the ears of some NDC faithfuls, but President Mills said what he believed was the right thing to do, and he meant every word of what he said. The accolade Asomdwoyeni, King of Peace, conferred on him by popular acclamation was a recognition of his preoccupation with the peace and unity of the nation. That was also his nature, his temperament. Peace-loving, soft-spoken, but make no mistake about it, he was firm in his convictions and would not yield to the dictates of others. When after the 2004 elections, there were calls on him to reject the results because of the way the role of the chairman of the Electoral Commission was usurped and the collusion between certain officials in the Electoral Commission and the incumbent government, he insisted that it was not worth spilling a drop of blood in the country simply because he was being denied the opportunity to serve as president. However flawed that result was, he decided not to contest it. He obviously believed he would live to fight another day. That was disappointing, even unacceptable to some, but that was his conviction. Being such a peacemaker was not a weakness. It was a mark of wisdom and maturity in a very polarized country. Those who thought his peaceful nature meant they could have President Mills do their bidding soon found out to their chagrin that they could not have their way with him. A hockey teammate of his has used the word grit to describe to me how focused President Mills was on the hockey pitch, especially within that half moon in the opponent's half. That grit was to serve him well in his leadership roles and as a person. Of course, he was a great team player and always paid attention to the perspectives of others. This was also very valuable to him when he first got into the NDC and during his service as vice president and chairman of the economic management team. Even as president, he relied on his team in his role as the striker. President Mills had a tremendous work ethic. He applied himself tirelessly to whatever assignment he was undertaking. He could never be accused of laziness. Even in a period when he was not in good health, he kept pushing himself to work right until he had to be taken to the hospital. He knew how to face tough times with a determined spirit and with a focus on what he considered the essentials, an aspect of the grit that was his hallmark. He was insistent on being punctual and would not accept the typical excuses we often make for starting meetings or functions late. Here again, he led by examples. All these attributes of President Mills, his integrity particularly, were anchored in his Christian faith, which clearly gave him the inner strength to be himself and to stand his ground. His faith was a matter of the heart and not about outward appearances or symbols. He understood the words of Jesus Christ in John 4:23-24. But a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship in the spirit and in truth. As president, he held a small gathering of worship and prayer on Sunday afternoons in a room between the president's living area and the castle and the office, and that became known as the chapel. There were those who ridiculed this and said he had turned the castle into a prayer camp. I'm told he was at that gathering on the Sunday, 22nd July 2012, before the Tuesday when he died. For President Mills, to live is Christ and to die is gain. Philippians 1:21. He strove to be Christ-like and chose to build for himself treasures in heaven and not on earth. He remained humble throughout his life, never assuming superior airs over others, always giving thanks to God for his life and recognizing that he was a creature just like others. When he was invited in 1996 by President Rawlings, may his soul rest in peace, to be his running mate, Professor Mills had not previously sought national elective office and had also not been involved in the political arena. He was an academic lawyer, not a politician, and certainly not involved in partisan politics. He was not somebody who sought political office. Rather, he was sought after to hold political office. Mills' integrity, as well as his humility and his dedication to public service, were clearly all character traits which attracted President Rawlings. He was sought after because of the contribution that he was thought he could make for the country and for the person, that is President Rawlings, and the party, the NDC, on whose ticket he was going to run. The choice of running mate, at a time when those opposed to President Rawlings had been given a boost by his own former vice president joining their ranks, was obviously an important one. Bringing in Professor John Evans Atta Mills proved to be an inspired choice that enabled President Rawlings and the NDC to retain the confidence of the electorate in the 1996 elections. Mills went on to prove himself an able, dedicated, and exemplary vice president. Professor Mills' character and personality, a person of integrity, someone who was peace-loving and not out to seek vengeance against political opponents, were huge positives. And his soft-spoken and gentle manner were an effective complement and balance to President Rawlings, whose own integrity and passion for the welfare of the ordinary man were obviously what made Mills accept to be his running mate. We must not forget, of course, that Professor Mills, as he was then, identified himself as an Nkrumahist and sometimes referred excitedly to the orientation that he received at the Kwame Nkrumah Ideological Institute while a student at Legon. He was therefore very much in tune with the political orientation of the NDC and fitted easily within the tradition. At the time he was announced as a vice presidential candidate, I recall that many of his contemporaries would say of him that he was a good man, and then quickly go on to doubt if he could succeed in what they regarded as the dirty world of politics. I will demonstrate that President Mills was a success in politics while not allowing himself to be tarnished by the dirt. He sought to clean up the politics of our nation. By the end of the second term of President Rawlings, he was clear in his mind that the mantle of leadership should pass on to his vice president. There were, however, others in the NDC who thought otherwise, and Professor Mills had to face leadership contests, which now gave him the opportunity to show his political mettle. I believe that a key part of what made him such an attractive presidential candidate for the NDC in the 2000 elections, as well as in 2004 and then in 2008, had to do with his character, precisely his integrity, modesty, and humility. For his selection as the NDC candidate for the 2008 election, Professor Mills had to withstand the challenge from a number of more established NDC personalities. And his success showed the clear grassroots backing from the delegates throughout the country for the person who they had not just seen operating as vice president, but whose personality and character had been exposed to them through the 2000 and 2004 election campaigns, and who they now viewed as beginning a new era for the party. So from a situation in 1996, when he could be described as a political neophyte and definitely a newcomer within the NDC, President Mills had become not just the leader and flag bearer of the party, the new face of the NDC, but he was the person who took the NDC from 8 years in opposition back to the presidency at the beginning of 2009. That was no mean political achievement, especially when we recall that he did not have at his disposal a fraction of the material resources that the party in government poured into their campaign. He could not do anything about the abuse of incumbency. He could not afford the huge, expensive billboards of his opponent. True to character, Professor Mills then launched what he called a door-to-door campaign, preferring direct encounters with the people whose votes he was courting through the length and breadth of the country. This was derided at that time by those in power. It was poor boy politics. But it has since become recognized as an important strategy for political campaigning in the country, even if large, expensive billboards are still, unfortunately, dominating our political contests and defacing our environment. Curiously, ahead of the 2012 elections, President Mills faced a challenge to the renewal of his NDC flag bearership from none other than Mrs. Rawlings, backed by her husband. The overwhelming success of President Mills at the party's Sunyani Congress sealed his position as the leader of the NDC. Two things often stand out in my mind about that Congress. The first is the deepening of the support of grassroots representatives of the party for President Mills. That he did not have the backing of President Rawlings on this occasion did not matter to them. The second thing from that Congress that I cannot forget is the speech of his Vice President at that time, Vice President John Mahama, who he had selected, you recall, as running mate at a time when others had other preferences. While backing Mills in that speech, Vice President Mahama offered a resounding message, couched in a wonderful storytelling style about the need for the unity of the party. President Mills was the person around whom a unified party now rallied. John Evans Atta Mills achieved political success with what I have called the charisma of integrity. Lack of integrity may seem to be politically successful for a time, but sooner or later, the deep human need for honesty and integrity breaks through. That is what we saw happen in Ghana in the election of John Evans Atta Fifi Mills as president in the 2008-2009 election. His integrity enabled us as a nation to call time on a previous era in which corruption was explained away as being as old as Adam. He was the option that exuded honesty, integrity, modesty, and all the character traits we have earlier outlined. At a time when corruption and political vengeance and the abuse of power were on full display from the incumbent government, and when Ghanaians were tired of the cycles of vengeance in our politics and disgusted with all the corruption, with natural resources being squandered for personal enrichment, Professor Mills was a breath of fresh air. Not only did he show that a good man with integrity as his banner can win in politics, but his election showed that character and virtue remain at the heart of human aspiration, and that even in politics, integrity matters. Deep in our hearts, most of us admire good men and women, and we aspire to be like them. Good men and women like President Mills are desperately needed in our politics to rescue us from the mire into which we have sunk. We have a responsibility to shape our politics so that good men and women can serve. Mills not only had the charisma of integrity, but also the aroma of integrity. Which he spread around him. And that sweet scent from President Mills is still in our midst today. That is why I am using this commemoration to challenge especially the youth of our country to make individual character and integrity critical determinants of who we place in leadership positions at all levels and in all contexts of our national life. Needless to say, corruption is more costly to the youth simply because they have a longer span of the future ahead of them. And what is squandered from national resources today leaves the youth with less resources to fix the country, to be the country we want, such that we can live the kind of lives that we all aspire to. It is not only in Ghana that the yearning for leaders of integrity is being expressed with more and more urgency. Throughout the world, lack of integrity in leaders is being exposed as unacceptable. Leaders who lie, some repeatedly and pathologically, or who are full of empty words that they do not mean. Leaders who are merely flamboyant and pompous, but do not seriously address the needs of their people, are being rejected and seen for who they really are, and not what the political propaganda says of them. Even at the highest levels of global leadership, we have experienced such leaders, including one who lies persistently about an election he lost and who has obviously provided an example for others about avoiding the truth in dealing with the electoral process. I was recently quite struck by how, in a debate amongst candidates for the leadership of the Conservative Party in the United Kingdom, when a question was asked directly, "Is Mr. Johnson honest?" with a request of a yes or no answer, only one person heeded the request, answering no to applause from the audience. The person who answered no, I must point out, is no longer in the leadership race. None of the others could answer yes. They danced around the question with talk about mistakes having been made and so on and so forth. The person they were talking about was none other than the Prime Minister of the United Kingdom, who had led his party to a massive electoral victory only 3 years ago, and yet whose character traits there have been issues about for decades. He is on his way out at last because his colleagues were apparently no longer comfortable with the lack of integrity. One of those colleagues has spoken about how attending a parliamentary prayer breakfast was the moment of truth for him. He says, "I was listening to Reverend Les Isaac talking about the importance of integrity in public life. And just focusing on that, I made up my mind. I went straight back to my office and drafted the resignation letter and went to see the Prime Minister later in the day." Those were the words of Sajid Javid, a former member of the cabinet of Prime Minister Boris Johnson. And in his resignation speech in Parliament, he spoke again about the prayer breakfast and about Reverend Les Isaac speaking about, quote, "the responsibility that comes with leadership, the responsibility to serve the interests of others above your own and to seek the common good of your party, your community, and above all, your country." Integrity was again his highlight. "The public expects all of us," he went on, "to maintain honesty and integrity in what we do. I have concluded that the problem starts at the top." We have also been seeing images recently of the crisis in Sri Lanka, which also tells us that there is a limit to the patience of a country after a long period of tolerance for a country that had been run as if it was a family business. And that had failed to address the dire living conditions faced by the people. A once very powerful president has had to flee from his country amidst the angry protests of the people who he had taken for granted for so long. The fact that in recent assessments of risks of debt default globally. Ghana and Sri Lanka are mentioned in the same breath, means that we cannot be complacent about our situation. We can't perhaps be spared that kind of tragedy in our nation. If the commemoration of the life and legacy of President Mills signals us, or signals to us, a need to follow his example of leadership. I would not be doing justice to the memory of President Mills if it seems that his moral attributes are all there was to the legacy of integrity that I'm talking about. In being elected as president, he undertook to make a difference to the real lives of the people of Ghana. And so it is appropriate to consider how he fared in that regard. We must start with the recognition that President Mills inherited an economy that was in disarray, with the previous government living beyond its means and recording large fiscal deficits in 2007 and 2008. This led to high levels of inflation in those years. The debts owed to two energy sector institutions, VRA and TOR alone, by the end of 2008 were almost $2 billion and rising. Rather than any measures being taken to address the economic imbalances, it was regularly claimed that the economy was doing very well. To compound the situation for the incoming government, commitments had been made to the single spine salary adjustments for public servants without any resources being available for this, nor a real plan for revenue generation to meet those commitments. It is to the credit of President Mills that the single spine salary structure was implemented, providing most public servants the benefits of improved remuneration. He was committed to those improved conditions of service because he knew the sacrifices of teachers, of doctors, of nurses, of policemen, of soldiers, judges, officials in the judicial service, all the security service, and public servants generally. The implementation of the single spine salary structure was achieved through improvement in economic management under President Mills, particularly the prudent fiscal management, which also enabled Ghana to experience significantly lower inflation from January 2009. From a level of 16.5% in 2008, inflation came down to single digits, 9.7%, in the very first year of Mills' administration, 2009. In 3 of the 4 years from January 2009 to December 2012, Ghana had single-digit inflation. 2 successive years of single-digit inflation were recorded in 2011-2012. Such lower inflation, by protecting the value of personal incomes, itself improved the well-being of the citizens. Fiscal responsibility was clearly practiced under President Mills. High growth rates were also recorded throughout the period of the Mills administration. Ghana's growth rate in 2011 was among the highest growth rates in the world that year. Some seek to attribute the impressive growth rates and the economic performance under President Mills simply to the onset of oil production from the Jubilee field. No doubt, growth in 2011 was elevated by the new revenues, but even non-oil growth in 2011 was higher than growth in the previous years before the Mills administration. And this is shown very clearly in a report. I don't know whether these figures are being displayed to you, but there are clear records of the effect of the oil and the non-oil growth, which we can refer to. But it is also interesting comparing the level of oil production and associated revenues during the Mills administration with the significantly increased levels in the years from 2017 to date, because this also gives us a perspective. The oil revenues earned in 1 year, 2018 alone, under the current government, are only about $8 million less than all revenues in the 2 years under President Mills, 2011 and 2012, when oil began to yield revenues. About 57% of all Ghana's oil revenues since 2011 have been available to the current government, as against 12% that was available to the administration of President Mills. More oil revenue was obtained during the 2017-2020 first term of the current government than in the term of any previous government. Despite these high levels of oil revenues, growth rates under the current administration have been consistently lower than under President Mills. Clearly, it is not the amount of oil revenue that matters. It is how that and all other revenues are managed for the benefit of the country. Credit cannot be denied President Mills for the improved economic performance, especially in terms of growth and inflation, as against what he inherited and compared to the current government, even though the oil revenue inflow during his period was so limited. There's a disturbing reality about our oil production that we need to pay more attention to than we have been doing. Since 2019, when a level of over 70 million barrels annual production was attained, production has been in decline. In 2021, just over 55 million barrels were produced. Significantly, it was a pipeline of oil and gas development projects from 11 new discoveries that were made during the 3.5 years of the presidency that led to the oil and gas production from the TEN and Sankofa and Jinyame fields. It is because of these that the level of oil revenues escalated from 2017. A similar pipeline of appraisal to development projects is urgently needed to reverse the decline in oil production that Ghana is currently experiencing. Ghana is still at a very early stage in uncovering the wealth of our oil resources, and there is every reason to be confident that the decline in production can be reversed for the good of the country. It will, however, require careful, well thought out, technically sound plans driven by what is in the national interest. More immediately, of course, we are faced with the issue of how best to utilize oil resources to enable us climb out of our current predicament. The passage of the Petroleum Revenue Management Act 2011, Act 815, was among the important legacies of President Mills. That act set limits to the amounts of revenues from oil production that are expended as part of annual budgets. A stabilization fund was established based on the recognition that some of the revenues needed to be saved to cushion the impact on or to sustain public expenditure capacity during periods of unanticipated petroleum revenue shortfalls, as it was expressed in Section 9 of the law. Such shortfalls in revenues from oil could arise from a plunge in oil prices or similar unexpected event. A heritage fund was also established, with the stated object being, quote, to provide an endowment to support the development for future generations when the petroleum reserves have been depleted and to receive excess petroleum funds. Transparency and accountability in respect of oil revenues and their utilization were also among the key objectives of the Act, and Section 8 provided for publication of data on petroleum receipts as well as petroleum output lifted and reference prices. The savings arrangements have already proved valuable to us, as a withdrawal was made from the stabilization fund during the early days of the COVID-19 pandemic. Under the Petroleum Revenue Management Act, investments of the Ghana Petroleum Funds are also required to be made in a manner that insulates them from being spent in annual budgets. Thankfully, therefore, the first half year 2020 report from the Bank of Ghana that was published as required by the Petroleum Revenue Management Act on 21st July 2022, the birthday of President Mills, records a closing value of $1,223,699,493 from investments of these funds. In the midst of ominous concerns about possible debt default and debates in Parliament about commercial loans with interest rates that are much higher than the interest being earned on our invested petroleum funds, is it too much to ask that, in the spirit of President Mills and in his honor, urgent, good faith, cross-party and non-partisan consultations are held to enable all our resource pools to be drawn on for the benefit of the people of Ghana? I have no doubt that this is what President Mills would have done. Important issues about the major oil discoveries, Mahogany and Shedria, that became the Jubilee Field development, were on President Mills' table from day one of his administration. And I will now go on to discuss how he handled them. I will do this to demonstrate further that what President Mills did with handling issues and decisions related to the oil and gas resource, what he did provides valuable reference points for issues that we are faced with today in the sector. The critical and urgent matter of approval of a development plan for the Jubilee Field required urgent attention right at the outset of the Mills presidency, if national expectations of significant oil production were to be met. Though the Jubilee partners had not yet formally put forward a plan, discussions had been going on that provided outlines of their intent. In particular, the focus of the partners on oil production led to proposals being put forward for an independent gas processing facility whose investors would offtake the gas at the wellhead and then sell to Ghana at $4 per standard cubic foot. There was pressure for this to be accepted quickly, but President Mills would not proceed without a thorough technical evaluation of this and all aspects of whatever was going to go into the development plan. He was in the process of appointing as Minister of Energy Dr. Oting Ejay, who he had confidence in to undertake the task. Not long after the appointment of the minister, Cosmos Energy on behalf of the Jubilee Partners, formally submitted the proposed plan of development. It was apparently their expectation that there would be almost instant approval. Indeed, at a famous meeting at the ministry in early May 2009, the then chief executive of Cosmos Energy rudely told the minister that he, the Cosmos Energy CEO, had decades of experience in the industry, and he did not understand why the minister could raise issues with the plan. The first account I had of this behavior at the meeting was from a representative of one of the other partners who had traveled into the country for the meeting, and he indicated that he and the representatives of the other partners were embarrassed by the behavior and utterances of the Cosmos Energy CEO and really impressed by the minister's calm authority. Even as Cosmos and partners mounted pressures, including through their diplomatic missions in Ghana, writing to the president, effectively requiring a rubber stamping of their proposed development plan, President Mills firmly backed Minister Otingeje and ensured that concerns raised about the plan were addressed and ministerial approval only granted after the plan satisfactorily advanced Ghana's national interests and in accordance with the laws of Ghana and international industry best practice. In the end, most significantly, as part of the negotiations related to the development plan, the Jubilee partners agreed that rather than their earlier plan in respect of the natural gas, they would supply the first 200 billion feet of gas of their share of gas from the Jubilee field to GMPC free of charge. In return, GMPC would be responsible for putting in place the infrastructure for the offtake of the gas at the wellhead. It is by virtue of this arrangement that rather than Ghana having to pay $4 per cubic foot for buying natural gas, with its impact on the price of power in Ghana, this superior arrangement was instituted and embodied in the approved plan of development. This free gas to GMPC has been an important element of gas supply to Ghana's power sector. President Mills was never eager to take credit for such achievements. He would rather give the credit to the minister and the GMPC personnel directly involved in the negotiations. While that was obviously appropriate, there is no doubt that his backing as president was critical in empowering the technically competent personnel to do their work. President Mills would never agree to a situation in which he accepted the proposals of the Jubilee partners and then required the technical personnel to act accordingly. The arrangements to have GMPC responsible for the gas infrastructure led to President Mills, on a state visit to China, securing financing from the China Development Bank for the construction by Sinopec of gas processing facilities at Atuabo and a gas pipeline to the plant. All this was truly part of the legacy of President Mills. Another challenging issue that soon faced President Mills before the beginning of oil production from the Jubilee field was when Cosmos Energy and ExxonMobil publicly announced that they had reached agreement for ExxonMobil to acquire Cosmos Energy. This was something that, by the terms of the petroleum law and the agreements under which Cosmos was operating, required approval of the government. Yet, it was presented initially as a fait accompli. It soon also emerged that without the knowledge, much less approval, of GMPC, contrary to the law and the petroleum agreements, Cosmos had provided data from their exploration activities in Ghana to ExxonMobil, as well as over 20 other companies in the industry. It was again the expectation of ExxonMobil and Cosmos that their transaction should be rubber stamped and issues about the illegalities overlooked. As U.S. companies ExxonMobil and Kosmos brought the full weight of the U.S. government to bear on the government of Ghana to support their position. The U.S. Assistant Secretary of State for African Affairs for African Affairs, Johnny Carsons, and others weighed in on President Mills to give in to the U.S. companies. Cosmos also hired a lobbyist to work on their behalf and to wage a campaign. Nasty articles surfaced in the U.S. press, notably the Wall Street Journal, the Washington Times, and Forbes, against the government and individuals believed to be against the transaction. Famously, a visa was denied the chairman of GMPC, Mr. Atta, who was to have traveled to the U.S. for meetings with Blackstone Capital, majority shareholders of Cosmos Energy. Not being intimidated by all this campaign, President Mills made it clear to the U.S. officials that he had nothing against the U.S. companies, but that the laws of Ghana must be respected, and that he, as president, would pursue the national interests of Ghana. He set up a committee headed by a distinguished Ghanaian economist at the World Bank, Dr. Gobind Nankani of blessed memory, and others. The committee was tasked to evaluate the various options of partnership open to GMPC, including ExxonMobil, as well as a consortium featuring BP and the China National Offshore Oil Corporation. Based on the work of the committee, President Mills again backed the minister and GMPC in pursuing a rival offer for Cosmos Energy that matched that of ExxonMobil. In the end, however, ExxonMobil, after Cosmos Energy shareholders sought to get more out of the transaction, announced that it would no longer proceed with the planned acquisition. Cosmos Energy also soon announced that it was no longer for sale, but was rather going to do an initial public offering on the New York Stock Exchange. Prior to the start of oil production from the Jubilee field, Cosmos reached agreement with GMPC on the government on the issue of illegally sharing GMPC data with third parties, and they paid $23 million, even though they refused to admit liability. I should just add a little footnote to the lobbyist that I mentioned, who was hired by Cosmos Energy to wage their campaign to try and get their way in connection with the ExxonMobil acquisition. She was the same person in 2016 hired by the campaign of then candidate Akufo-Addo for the 2016 election. And she uses her engagement in that campaign as a case study on the website of her company with the title Unseating the Incumbent in Ghana's Presidential Election 2016. You can read that case study at their website, krlinternational.com/case-study-Ghana-election. The integrity of President Mills, his reliance on rigorous technical evaluation of options, his empowering of technocrats and the relevant institutions, such as the ministry and GMPC at the time, to do the groundwork that was needed for sound government decision making, his relentless pursuit of the national interest, all served Ghana well. The onset of significant oil production could have accentuated corruption and self-seeking at the expense of the nation. President Mills would have none of that. If our efforts to achieve the best for our nation from our resources are to succeed, the clarity of focus on the national interest that President Mills had represents a constant lodestar for decision making. It is not my intention today to deal with every aspect, every area of significance in the Better Ghana agenda of President Mills. I will only deal briefly with one final area that is currently under discussion from a variety of perspectives. That is the issue of review of the Constitution. A high-powered Constitutional Review Committee was set up by President Mills, chaired by Professor Albert Fiagio, a distinguished academic. It is unfortunate that the important work of this committee is not informing much of the talk of constitutional reform. I have no doubt that it will be beneficial for those concerned about constitutional reform to benefit from the important work not only of this review committee but also the work of the committee under the chairmanship of Nana Dr. SKB Asante, which worked on the 1992 Constitution and presented it to the Consultative Assembly. Nana Chairman, I recall that you were a member of that 1992 Consultative Assembly and that you were also a member of the 1979 Constituent Assembly that drew up the 1979 Constitution. So you are eminently qualified to speak with authority and to draw attention, for instance, to how much work on the 1992 Constitution took the 1979 Constitution as a starting point. I humbly request people like you to speak up because there is, I have to say, some very uninformed talk about the 1992 Constitution that gets an audience. When I hear a call for review of the Constitution, that is based on the wholly false promise, the wholly false premise that it was a constitution just designed for Flight Lieutenant Rawlings, I wonder if it is just ignorance or brazen falsehood or perhaps a toxic combination of the two that is on display. You, Nana Chairman, played a history-making role together with others in respect of the Constitution, and I hope, therefore, you will not be offended by my request. Many aspects of our current predicament as a nation, in any case, are not addressed by constitutional reform. When we're dealing with corruption and its negative impact on our development, when we talk about the weak institutions that we have, or the complicity in wrongdoing of people supposed to play important roles to check abuse of power, changing provisions in the Constitution will not resolve those issues. When we talk about issues concerning remuneration for Article 71 office holders, it is not really an issue of constitutional reform. It is an issue of what a state with limited resources should pay to various people in public service and the relativities of different levels and contexts of service. The single spine salary adjustment process involved some consideration of relativities, which will always be important. It is understandable that concerns arise as to why part-time work as a member of the Council of State should go with a level of monthly remuneration that is about 20 times that of a full-time teacher and with an end-of-service package as well. More especially when a number of the members of the Council of State retired on their salaries as public servants. In all this, we each have our personal responsibility for assessing what is the right thing for the nation. It is the essence of the legacy of integrity of President Mills that it was never about himself, but always about the welfare of others, the good of the nation. Discussions for reform of the Constitution are important and necessary, but they must not distract attention from pressing issues about harsh living conditions, issues about the crisis of the economy and excessive borrowing and so on, nor be a way of taking the focus away from addressing the corruption that is rampant in our midst. I have chosen today to use the memory of President Mills to call attention to the fundamental need for integrity in public life, in politics, in those who seek or hold leadership positions. I believe that we pay a heavy price for our failure to insist on integrity as a necessary qualification for those who seek high office. It is unfortunate how we shut our eyes to corruption when it is from our party, and so we lack the moral authority to confront corrupt practices by others. President Mills built on his personal integrity to deliver leadership success and initiate the Better Ghana agenda. He showed that integrity mattered to deliver economic benefits, because it is the integrity deficit that regularly gets translated into fiscal deficits. He was effective in delivering on governmental goals because of his integrity. At this critical time in our nation's existence, at this time of economic crisis, of social unrest and political disaffection, President Mills, as a standard bearer of integrity, beckons us all to establish better governance as the basis for a better Ghana. Better governance is about making our institutions work effectively and not just for our party members. It is also not about coveting power for an individual or for the party. It is about serving the whole polity. That is what President Mills meant by being a president for all and not just for members of his party. I quote some further words of his in that June 18, 2008 speech, which have a chilling resonance. He said, "Is it not ironical that 7 or 8 years is long enough to make some elected officials and their families fabulously wealthy, and yet they say 8 years is too short a time to solve problems of poverty for the generality of the masses?" End of quote. President Mills beckons the youth of this country especially to make a foundation of integrity the bedrock of our nation building. The youth recognize starkly that their current existence and their prospects for the future are jeopardized by the lack of integrity in our nation, by leaders who frankly have less of a stake in the future that lies ahead, but who make fulsome promises for electioneering purposes. Today, President Mills' integrity, his good judgment, his wisdom can still guide us in making the right decisions that the oil and gas sector, for instance, that I discussed at some length, can be a driver of national development and well-being of all Ghanaians and not a source of corrupt personal enrichment. The legacy of integrity of President Mills is so important today in Ghana. Integrity matters. Speaking the truth matters. Character matters in nation building. Indeed, integrity, honesty, speaking the truth, virtue are fundamental to human existence. And so they are important in political life and in political systems. Without these basic human qualities, there is no trust among members of society, and we risk a descent into anarchy. That is why the legacy of President Mills needs to be embraced and become a guiding light for us. I encourage the memorial heritage to propagate the message of what President Mills stood for and the relevance of his life and legacy to our country. His integrity, his humility, his modesty, his sheer decency, his hard work are all worthy of emulation if this country is to rise up to its promise. I'm really touched by the message from First Lady Nadu Mills to us today. Allow me to quote her as I end. Fifi was often battered and bruised on the battlefield of politics, but he held firm to his personal values of truth, simplicity, honesty, and abiding respect for all. These are the qualities I loved about him. To Fifi, serving at the highest echelons of government was an opportunity to help change the character of Ghanaian politics for the better. In this regard, I believe posterity will judge him well. I believe so too. The legacy of President Mills lives on. I miss President Mills. Thank you. Oh,
beautiful voice called Chris Salome. Thank you very, very much. Okay, pretty shortly we'll be having a closing remarks from our chairman. Before then, the Tema Youth Choir will give a rendition or two, and then we'll go over to our chairman. Thank you. Please remain seated until the end of the program. Thank you. Shall we now invite the chairman for his closing remarks? Please put your hands together as we invite Nana Utuo Sribo, chairman of the Council of State.
There's so much background noise, I'm wondering whether I'll be heard. I should have brought my court criers here. You know, would have had to call you to order. But unfortunately, this being a civic function, I didn't think it put them to bring them. Next time when you invite me, I'll bring them along. So that the order will be restored in a traditional sense. After a brilliant keynote or lecture, the chairman has to have a very difficult task. And what I may refer to surely can be described as a footnote and nothing further than that. Not the footnote that Mr. Chajishgata referred to, but my own footnotes. We have been treated this evening to a very brilliant lecture by a brilliant person. Just the week before last, there was a caption in the Mirror going back to history. And in that Mirror report, there was a story of somebody having obtained first class in law at the age of 20. And if you are commemorating the demise of Professor Atta Mills, I think it's just as well that we should also remember that about 52 years ago, Chatu obtained a first class in law from the University of Ghana. At the tender age of 20, I think he's still a young man. We've been treated to a whole aspect of the life of Professor Mills, his moral attributes, his governance style, the structure of his governance, some key landmarks, some landmarks in his administration, the implementation of the single spine, his prudent management of state resources, his establishment of a heritage fund, his reliance on technocrats in the national interest, and putting self in country above self. These are very commendable attributes indeed, and I think that the lecture may be made public so that we can digest them in greater detail. A personal challenge, a personal invitation was thrown at me, not a challenge. A personal invitation was thrown at me, and even though we are not in court, and who am I to contest Chachu in court, I would attempt to give an answer or to give an insight into what is being done. It is true that I played a part in the 79 and the 92 constitutions. And in the 92 constitution, some of my very eminent classmates were the Honorable Johnson Edun Ketia, who was a member of the business committee. And a time was when there was a motion, and Edun had to get up to support the motion. And he predicated his statement this way: "Mr. Speaker, I want to put my full weight behind this motion." And since, unfortunately, the weight was not existent, the motion was lost. And other classmates of mine were Honorable Collins Dauda, Honorable Mohammed Mumuni. I've seen him in the screenshot. Oh, you are here. Yes, he used to sit at the back and be throwing, you know, at us. And Martin Amidu, and a whole host of them. And we had, you know, our own differences, not of a political nature, but as regards our convictions on one aspect or other of the Constitution. Surely, we did not all agree on all the articles. In fact, there were instances where key articles which were voted on upon were won by a vote or two, and we had to go into a division. So we could see from the very onset that the vehicle that we were designing, if it were put in the hands of a driver, the driver would immediately report about faulty brakes, poor transmission, lack of carburetor, air fuel ratio in their carburetors and all. But that notwithstanding, a start had to be made. And I'm happy to report that since becoming chairman of the Council of State, I've initiated actions and moves to have some aspects of the Constitution looked at. Honorable Harun Naidusu here will bear me out that at the Speaker's Forum in Kumasi, I gave a very spirited opinion as to why we feel that some aspects of the Constitution should be looked at one more time. And since then, we've been working assiduously towards getting a consensus on the way forward. And to that end, the Council of State is currently in active consultations with the Africa Center for Economic Transformation, ISET, led by Dr. Kewe Mwako. In fact, just last week, two members of the council were in Villa Lodge to have a day or two consultations with the greater group. We are giving notice. Come September, we are going to have a larger consultative body comprising the executive, the legislature, judiciary, traditional authorities, faith-based organizations, labor, organized labor, civil society organizations, probably in this very hall, to look at key areas of convergence so that we can all move with one voice and with one in one step, in unison. Because surely, if you don't examine some of the processes, they may detract from achieving the set goals that we have. We want to look at chapters like the directive principles of state policy, which though are very, very effective and very pungent and very pertinent to our national discourse, are non-justiciable, so that we sort of sweep them under the carpet. But if in this polarized political atmosphere, we all stuck to the principles enshrined in the directive principles of state policy, we may go quite far. We're getting too much problem with adversarial politics in this country. And I think the time has come for us to sit and jaw, as the speaker said. We need that type of Professor Mills attitude where it is not for me, but for us. And if the current is, if the present is well prepared, then the future will be easy for posterity. Because we need to devote a lot more time to ensuring that some of these key things are done. So very soon you will be getting an invitation from the Council of State. We are coordinating all these activities, and we hope that the views that you bring on board will be thoroughly discussed before we go to the general public. And it would not be owned by a political party, because we have if I were at the palace, I would have thought that was in Tahara. So that we should all own them and not make it seem as if that since it was said by Mr. A and I'm on the other side of the political spectrum, whether there's merit in it or not, I'm going to reject it. I don't think it will bode well for the interests of our country. And we have a lot more years ahead for the youth than we elderly, we would spend probably on this earth. So we need to put aside our political gaps and look at the country as one whole, the country which God in his wisdom planted us into, and make sure that it becomes a better Ghana and it becomes a country which will serve us and which also we will also shall serve with the best intentions and with the best of spirits. Thank you very much for inviting me.
Please, shall we accompany him to his seat with a round of applause? Thank you very much. Before I express the gratitude of organizers, I'd like to acknowledge Professor Francis Dodu. Thank you so very much for joining us. Professor Kofi Abuchi, Honorable Dan Abudakbi, Mrs. Charlotte Osei, Nana Ansong, member of the Council of State, all our former generals, Air Vice Marshal Sam Senoje, General A.B. Kwote, General Drisu, General Bray, and all other generals and retired officers here, all former ambassadors and high commissioners, members of the local organizing committee of the Northern Cluster, Western and Central Clusters, and of course the local organizing committee here. We acknowledge you all. At this stage, ladies and gentlemen, please join me. Let us thank these individuals. Nana Asante Juabehene, Peninfose, Enidium, Omodawa Sibibri, and Enidia, Odiabe Jumei Hom, Sir Winyamre, Nawa Babetsnam, Ame Jumei, Ashasini, and I was with us with some Peninfose Omodawa Sibibri. Dogby, Badagugu, Aquanausia, Aquanau Kakaka, Mauna Yrao, and Antanana. Mama Jane, Mavi Odende, Edwasa Papa Pai, Edwasa Nawimbere Yamahin. Dr. Cadman, no way with something in the for 7 country under what was a papa. As it in a Sakuko and Kukrukua, Nasin Kotan was Ramahan, Edwana say. And then me, Dungby Leome, Yachue, Yachumika, I want to join you away, Niche. Wange jesi na yo wo ke watesion maudrum ne jonye bawe nyenilo nyachum nime name ni kwa si goloko we bi o min danye fe si akenye keje wale e ba pian wo se wona nye fe ke si ni wa jonye wo ke bo wo gbe gogo ti oku president wo ke hanye nyenilo e do bia se mejina mo na mada shake Nuhu Sharabutu, National Chief Imam, and his entourage, and of course, Archbishop Bonaventure, for their presence here, making sure they grace the occasion for us. And to each and every one of you distinguished people here, without leaving anybody out, the Council of Elders have asked me to thank everybody for you, and God bless you all. At this stage, I'd like to ask our Muslim brothers to join us. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman Rahim, Malik Yawmiddin, Yaakana Abudu wa Yaakana Astahim, Idina Surat al-Mustaqim, Surat al-Azina Amt Alayhim, Geru Makdubi Alayhim wa Ladwali, Amen. Glory be to the Almighty Father and the Most Sacred High. Perfect peace, perfect health, long life and prosperity be unto you and I now and forevermore. Amen. Thank you for coming.